The education sector is at the centre of many different trends, from changing generations of students and teachers, to adopting the curriculum to suit the future of work, to responding to changes brought about by the pandemic, to focusing on teacher and student wellbeing, and collecting data and knowing what to do with it. Clearly, there is a lot on the plate for those working in the education sector. Therefore, it's no wonder that when we speak to educators, they're feeling a bit fatigued and a bit overwhelmed. Yet, we are here to tell everyone that there is hope. If leaders in the sector take the time to understand the trends at play and how to utilise the data at their disposal, they can make informed and strategic decisions going forward. So, joining me on the podcast today to discuss the role of data science in the future of education is my colleague and data scientist, Mike Abecina. Mike, welcome to your debut onto the Future Report podcast.
Hey, Ash, and thank you very much for having me. I'm looking forward to it.
Our whole team, I think, has been pretty excited to get you on here. You're kind of a bit of an enigma in terms of you've got this really cool set of skills and really interesting way of thinking. But before we get into your history of your career, could you tell everyone what generation you belong to?
Right. So I literally like scrape in to be Generation Y. Like I'm definitely on the older side of that, which is okay. I grew up listening to, you know, good 90s music. And I remember my parents saying, you know, and 90s music sort of characterized by like grunge and hip hop. And I remember my parents saying that both of those things are such negative influences on your life. And yet here I am. I turned out okay, unless I actually am a bad person and no one's told me. So, yeah.
Nice. I am on the younger end of the Gen Ys. So right. We kind of are at the different ends of the same generation, which is interesting.
Okay. So I guess the difference is that I can eat my avocado and toast and actually afford it. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. You won't be badgered maybe as much about it as my generation have been condemned for our love of, very expensive smashed oven with a side of goat's cheese. But no, it is. There are some differences there. And I'd love to hear, or if you could share actually a bit of your career trajectory, because you joined the McCrindle team recently and we knew each other before working together. So what's been your career journey, Mike?
Yeah, so we'll get into that soon. So I actually started off as a high school teacher, which is really strange because I never actually studied education into teaching. So I actually studied actuarial studies, which is like this highly enumerate, I guess, stereotypically boring profession, and yet found myself in education because I'd finished my degree 6 months early and I wanted to try my hand at something while, you know, just sort of save up some money, but I love teaching. And so I stuck with maths teaching for a number of years. And one of those students, really special kid, was yourself, Ashley. Yeah, so that would have been back in, 2010?
Yeah.
You were a good student. I think you tend to really downplay yourself in terms of like, you know, I was really bad at maths, but that is not true. She was great. I taught maths for a number of years. I became the head of the maths department, and it was in, I guess, that role where I really understood not just the maths and the teaching side of things, but just how schools run and engaged with, you know, the higher ups, the executives, and what tried to understand, I guess, what some of their concerns were and what some of their, I guess, pursuits are for education. And so I was head of maths for a number of years, but also in that role, I really gained a passion for data. Because a large part of the head of faculty role is to understand, you know, what your students are learning, and data is, I guess, the vehicle for that. And so I picked up some skills and some tools and was lucky enough to sort of move to the other side of, I guess, the types of roles that appear in school. So I actually moved into the IT sort of side of things, which is quite strange in education. Mm. Like rarely do you have people moving from the classroom to, I guess, the tech side of things. But so, you know, sort of dabbled in that and was then the head of data strategy, where we thought a little bit about, you know, how we're going to use data as an organization. And then, so now we're in 2020 and I sort of bit the bullet and decided, you know what, I really want to go full on with this data stuff. And so I transitioned, retrained, and became a data scientist. And my first role was at the ATO, where I was a data scientist and a machine learning engineer. And I guess in that role, we did a lot of, you know, machine learning, deep learning, and using, I guess, a lot more advanced sort of AI techniques to, yeah, understand data. And I gained a real sort of love and interest in sort of language data, and I knew that McCrindle sort of managed a lot of that stuff, managed a lot of survey data, and so here I am as a data scientist at McCrindle.
So cool. Yes, I remember when you started here, and I had to go through that journey of like, you're not Mr. Abecina anymore, you're Mike, as everyone does when they leave school and teachers are no longer teachers.
It's a real thing, right? Like, you actually have to train yourself not to say that. Yeah.
Absolutely. But my reflection on you as a teacher was that you were excellent. And you were like the coolest maths teacher. I feel like you had like a bit of swag. Like, that's kind of how I would describe you as a maths teacher.
That's like the first time you've said that. Okay.
I've been saving it for the podcast. On a very public platform.
No, that's awesome. No, I definitely have a real sort of fond memory of, yeah, teaching maths.
Yeah. And something else I remember at the time, weren't you studying like English as well as your own maths teacher?
Yeah.
That's pretty rare, right? Like, most people are one or the other, not both.
Yeah, that's true. And it was actually in my English studies that I sort of broadened my understanding of, I guess, you know, how to think critically, how to evaluate, you know, opinions of the world. But I also found real close similarities with the maths that I'd been learning. Yeah, which is, if I was to go back to high school, I think I would do better at English, knowing how closely related to maths it is. Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. And you, as you mentioned, you've got a bit of a history as a data scientist, and you've got that key role here at McCrindle. And I feel like it's a job that we talk about in our presentations around the future of work and emerging jobs. I mean, we've got more data at our fingertips today than ever before. Every organization's got to have a data management plan, let alone like how they use it strategically. So I feel like that the term data scientist sounds both cool and a little bit ambiguous. How do you describe to people the work that you do as a data scientist?
Yeah. So as you mentioned, like, data is really important, and trying to uncover what, I guess, the data is saying is vital for how businesses run, how businesses plan for the future and that sort of thing. So what a data scientist is, I guess, is someone who has a lot of the skills and tools to examine what that story of data is really saying. So I think a lot of people have, I guess, a generic skill of being able to see patterns. I guess what data scientists have is a statistics knowledge, sort of like an AI knowledge, and sort of software engineering background to be able to extract those, I guess, insights on a larger scale. But I guess that's one aspect of it. But another aspect of it is just being a good communicator and being able to communicate those insights in the most relevant way. So it could be, you know, a printed report, or it could be, you know, an interactive dashboard. An aspect that I'm working on at the moment is an actual sort of software app where our researchers are able to engage with, I guess, this AI model to be able to see, what the data is actually saying, which I'm pretty excited about.
Yeah, I know our team are loving having you on board and having your experience in both the education sector as a teacher and as someone who was, looking at data strategically, but then also as a qualified, working data scientist. And I guess there's a few connections, but are there any that stand out to you around the connection between data science and education specifically?
Well, it's an interesting one, because if you were to ask me that probably 7 or 8 years ago, I would probably say that link is quite tenuous, because data science is usually reserved for those organizations that accumulate heaps of data, like your sort of big tech and your retail. But more and more, education is becoming a big sort of accumulation of data as students are interacting with their learning on these online platforms. And so even, I guess, your own experience where, your interaction with sort of teachers was either face-to-face or via email. Nowadays, it's through online platforms, which are, constantly accumulating data. And so schools need to sort of figure out what's going on there. And that was really heightened in the pandemic, where, all the students were at home, you had zero visibility on what was going on, yet you had this platform, like a learning management system, that was just accumulating tons of data. And so that's going to be the future, I think, as, I guess, schools are, you know, moving more to online platforms, really needing to extract, well, what is the story going on here? Are students, you know, for example, submitting work online? What's the time between, you know, assessment A, assessment B? Are students actually attending all the meetings that they're supposed to? You can get those insights really quickly.
Yeah, I can imagine that a lot of schools have just are feeling that, and organisations in general, actually, just around collating more data because so many people had to go online. But again, for the education sector, they literally had no choice. Mm. So collecting more data than ever before, I imagine that can be maybe a bit overwhelming for a sector that hasn't maybe done that as much. And so, Mike, do you have any kind of top line advice or steps that leaders in the education sector particularly can take to sort of utilise all this data they have at their fingertips?
Yeah, I would say that the very first step is a mindset, that it's about realising that the data that you have and the data that you are going to continue to accumulate is valuable. And I think what happens in schools is schools tend to be very reactive and pragmatic about their data and don't think about an overall data plan. If you imagine that your data is like an asset to the school, then you would want to think about ways of managing that. And you want to make sure that, for example, that your data is, I guess, kept in a safe, standardized sort of place, like a database, that the people who need it have access to it. And schools mostly have people qualified to do that. So people are qualified to be able to, I guess, get data from different sources, store it in a database. And even though they can't think of the immediate need right away, at least you're treating it as if, yes, this does have value. I can't figure out what that value is yet, but it will. I think that's the first thing. And I think the second thing is for schools to recognize, well, rather than just think about, I guess, systems and, okay, let's just get the data in a database and not think about, well, think about what are the core things that your school does. So, and what are the core, I guess, parts of what a school does whereby data is an important piece of. So, for example, schools are concerned and thinking about enrollments. They're asking the question, you know, where are our students going to be coming from in 2025, 2030? And we need to, I guess, plan for that. And having, I guess, strong sort of alignment with the business objectives of a school helps in terms of the planning of, well, how are we going to collect this data and what type of data are we going to collect and how are we going to store it, who's going to have access to it. So I think it's a combination of, okay, well, why are we here? What are the systems that are going to get us to move from A to B? And it sort of builds from there. And I think more and more data scientists are realizing that it's not about the technical skills. It's actually about plugging into business value. And so, yeah, for schools, I think that's the best place to start.
Mm, some really good tips there. And I've been at a few conferences lately where people are talking about, yeah, those data management sort of plans. And I mean, it's pretty dire, but some of them are even thinking like more in the strategic business manager side around what would happen if we got a cyber attack and our data was sort of pulled into kind of held, I don't know if the right term, but like held ransom. Like there, and
they're real things.
Yeah, real threats. So I can understand if people are a bit hesitant and a bit scared, but like you said, there's so much opportunity to understand the community that you're engaging with and their story. And like you said, the human story side of the data and what it's saying about, yeah, future enrollments and strategic planning and all those things that we tend to operate in that space as well. And I mean, I'm sure that you were aware of maybe McCrindle prior to working here because we tend to have a bit of reputation in the education sector. We do a lot of that generational analysis and learning about the generations does lend itself well to the education sector. You're both someone who has worked in it and now you're working, I guess, on the research side as a bit of an external commentator to it. So I'm aware this is a massive question, but I'm posing it to you anyway in terms of what do you see, Mike, as being the key trends impacting the future of the education sector?
Yeah, no, that's a big question. I'll probably start with, I guess, the pedagogical side, like the learning side.
Yeah.
And then I'll address probably the staff side as the second point. So I guess firstly, definitely with regards to, say, learning and how curriculum is being taught, there is a strong emphasis towards personalization. So, and I guess what I mean by personalization is having a curriculum that is tailored towards a lot of student choice, student agency. And so I guess a way in which that is happening is through a broader array of subjects and different credentials as well. So things like micro-credentialing, having, I guess, a portfolio of works that is supplementary to, say, an ATAR. And speaking of ATAR, I think that, you know, while I personally think that ATAR is quite an important thing, I think within the education sector, it's certainly, I guess, being questioned, and people are thinking of ways to supplement that with not so much getting rid of it, but probably supplementing it with other, I guess, demonstrations of student understanding and student work. So you've got organisations and research institutions like University of Melbourne who are developing, I guess, new metrics for learning and, you know, things that have to do with, say, critical thinking, communication, and those things being the ways in which we measure student achievement. So I guess on that side, there is this move away towards traditional sort of assessment, traditional measures like ATAR, and towards more, I guess, how you say it, 21st century sort of skills.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the second trend, and this is probably the one that is, I guess, the most important, I think, is what's happening with staff. And so you've got this situation where, and I've never seen this in any other industry really, where you have the whole profession really doubting its own sustainability. Mm. And yeah, it's a little bit of a scary time where you have teachers who are so, I guess, overworked, and who can't see a real way out either. So there is a sense in which these frustrations of, you know, sort of students falling behind in their learning, complete under-resourcement of staff, these concerns being falling on deaf ears. And so there is, I guess, to some extent, a real anxiety about, well, is anyone actually taking notice of this? Which is a big deal, right? But having said that, it also depends where you are. So I really think what's happening amongst staff is there is, I guess, it depends what school you're at and how well resourced your school is. So you have some, like a situation where schools that are really well resourced, really ahead of the game, have really curbed this sort of, you know, or protected themselves from, I guess, you know, a burnout and large class sizes. But then you have other schools like smaller independent schools and public schools who are perhaps really struggling. And again, there's, you know, another level of disconnection going on there. So I remember during the pandemic, there was this song, you know, we're all in this together, as being this anthem that really, you know, that we rallied to, and it made us sort of feel like, you know, our concerns were being heard. I think now in education, especially amongst staff that I'm speaking to and what I'm reading, yeah, it's not really the case.
Mm. Yeah. It's huge. And I think that staff wellbeing piece is really something that, like, we saw that pre-COVID in our annual education future report. I think it was 2019.
Yeah, 2019.
Yeah, we did some research, some focus groups and some surveys of staff and parents, and teachers were saying that at the time, under-resourced, like you mentioned, just greater expectations, even as student wellbeing demands increase, as student mental health increases, staff mental health increases as well, as a direct correlation, because the issues or the challenges that kids are facing, they're bringing into the classroom, and then teachers have got to deal with that, and they're not feeling qualified, let alone all the extra admin work, let alone all the marking and outside of like school hours or work time work that has to be completed. Mm. I was sharing with you and some of the team recently, I think it was you actually that said it to me when I was in high school. You were like, are you going to become a teacher? And I'd shared it with you before, because I always wanted to become a teacher. But something in me was like, oh, I kind of just didn't want to go uni school. I thought maybe I'll circle back to teaching one day. And then I found social research and I've been here ever since. But part of me, I still love the profession. I've got a lot of friends who work as teachers. But I have to be honest, the idea of all the out of hours work kind of turns me off it. Like, there's just so much. I mean, have you found that now that you've come out of the sector and you're not working in education, are you enjoying not having to do all the marking?
Yeah. Well, I think no part of me in 2022 wishes that I was marking exams, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Certainly at the time. So what happens with teachers is, I guess, they're really driven by this innate passion to really want to help students.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's really important. Like, I think that's a necessary thing for teachers to have.
Mm-hmm.
once you move out of, I guess, education, you start to realize that that is insufficient. It's insufficient to just have a desire. You've also got to, if you like, have a real respect for professionalism and recognize that, you know, there are certain standards by which our work should be thought of and by which we should be, you know, paid against, by which, you know, work conditions should be of a certain level. And you're sort of blinded to that when you're in education because you just, you're just so, I guess, you know, invested in kids' future or so invested in wanting to make sure that kids are understanding your subject better that you sort of, you sort of forget just that you're in a profession and you need to sort of, I guess, promote teaching as a profession as much as just a desire to make the world better. Yeah.
I've heard lots of educators and even in an online virtual event I was at recently talking about teaching as that vocation and that's that calling, and a lot of teachers sacrifice their own well-being and time with family and time in term to, like you said, the responsibility of the kids they're teaching, which is amazing. And like you said, I think some people think, oh, if you can't do, you teach. Like, and I just don't agree with that at all. Like, teachers, it's not a fallback career. And I'm sure many teachers, including yourself, would identify with that. But yeah, that's some really great advice. I mean, do you have any other ideas on how we start to shift this unrealistic expectation that is placed on teachers around work and well-being and that sort of thing?
Yeah, I mean, it's a real complex thing, right? And it's been something that is, I guess, precipitated by the pandemic. But as you mentioned, it's been something that's been going on much longer. I think, you know, as a data scientist, my first sort of, I guess, idea would be, well, let's get data on what's actually going on. So how much time are teachers actually spending outside of the classroom? How much time are they, you know, sending emails outside of work hours, which I know is a thing. How much time are they spending marking, and really get some proper metrics to understand, well, this is a real problem that needs addressing. And I think the second thing that we can be doing is, I guess, really listening to teachers. And you know, people have different opinions about, you know, the teacher experience, and what they're feeling is probably more similar to other industries than teachers sort of admit, whatever that might mean. But at one level, that's what teachers are feeling. And so it's really important that you actually still listen to that and have, you know, education policy leaders to sort of understand, well, this is the anxiety and the frustration that teachers, I guess, are feeling. So that would probably be my second tip. Probably the third one, this one, I guess, sort of inflects back onto the teachers, and it's sort of what I was mentioning earlier, is really recognizing that you are part of a profession and, I guess, owning that. And, you know, it's great and it's really important to be there for kids and to give 110%. But there are some, I think, I guess, actions that teachers take that could send it, how you say it, unhelpful in terms of progressing the, or raising the standards of professionalism higher, I think. So really calling out the fact that your work conditions are substandard, or really voicing that, yeah, I actually, you know, think that in terms of other professions whose, you know, pay is commensurate to the level of expertise that they're, you know, gaining on the job, I think, you know, voicing the concern, well, this should sort of be similar in education. Yeah, and that's not necessarily putting aside the fact that you're in education because you love it. It's just recognising both that, yeah, I'm in something that I love, and I also think, you know, we deserve some sort of recognition for that.
Yeah, there's some really helpful starting points, I think, and weaving data science in there as well, and understanding, like you said, even not just, and that's the case that we, I guess, make about research, and the power of data is that it's evidence-based rather than I'm feeling this way. If you can show a case for it with kind of hard numbers, it can be hard to argue with.
That's exactly right.
But yeah, it gives that backing. But yeah, I think I'd be also interested, maybe we should run a survey of it, just around maybe as well, hopefully one of the silver linings, anecdotally to me anyway, it has appeared that during the pandemic, because, you know, so many families across the world had to do learning from home, that we almost gave like teachers, the teaching profession, a massive kind of boost in terms of the value of it, because parents went, wow, this is so hard to maybe wrangle and teach just one or two kids in the house, let alone a teacher, you know, with lots of kids there. So maybe that's maybe one tiny silver lining, but it's not enough to just go, great job, teachers. Like you said, it needs to be more maybe transformation around valuing their contribution and prioritising their well-being as well. So
well and truly, I think it is as much, how do you say it, structural as it is sentimental. So at one level, there is the sentiment that, yeah, thank you very much. But the structures need to reflect that.
Yes, absolutely. I've got a really interesting question for you, Mike, because I find that when I'm out speaking at events to education and in light of the hybrid learning models we talk a lot about and we have on the podcast in many past episodes, the future of work, hybrid ways of working, flexible working, work from home. I feel like the education sector historically hasn't really lent itself to that. How can teachers work from home, you know, when they've got a class in the classroom? So there's an element there, because I think what we're seeing in our even education future research this year is that the emerging generation of workers, therefore the emerging generation of teachers who are kind of wrapping up their education now, are expecting hybrid ways of working in the future. So how does the education self sort of lend itself to that? How does the education sector attract teachers to a profession that doesn't naturally lend itself to working from home, like say an office environment does? But also even not just the teaching component there, but also even the whole learning component. And a few people are going, oh, what's the future of education? Is it hybrid? I've heard of one school apparently in Melbourne who's gone fully virtual, and even speaking to someone recently in the office saying they've heard of a school in New South Wales. I've got my own perspectives and opinions on the value of being in the room with students, not being a teacher myself, but what's your perspective on the future of the sector in terms of hybrid and a mix and virtual? Do you think we'll have many fully virtual schools in the future?
I think it's I guess one of the real benefits of educators is, and it's a really great quality of educators, is that they love to experiment. And I think that's really important. I think it's really important that teachers at the forefront are experimenting with different ways of delivering content. And yes, these fully online schools, yeah, definitely have heard of them. I do think that there will be, I guess, a part of that experimentation phase of, you know, let's just see how school students are learning. There's definitely a clear, how do you say it, like a unique value proposition in that, in the sense that students will be at home, more flexibility, allowing, I guess, you know, more flexibility for parents as well, possibly. So there's definitely a unique value proposition there. But I also am considering the research around just pedagogy and how students learn best. And we know from, I guess, educational research that one of the key contributors to the way a student learns is the relationship that they have with the teacher, the educator. And I guess if schools were to go fully online, you've got to sort of ask the question, how well developed can that relationship get when, you know, you're never in the same room as your teacher? Or and I'm not someone to immediately doubt that. It's just probably something that needs to be, I guess, you know, spelled out, or it needs to be sort of addressed and needs to be worked on in order for, I guess, you know, these fully online schools to get more traction. In terms of the hybrid stuff, though, yeah, I definitely think that's the future. There's a real convenience with, I guess, being able to, you know, if a teacher is needing to look after their child, for example, traditionally that means that, okay, they can't go to work. But having some sort of hybrid model allows teachers to still be able to work and still be able to do other things around the home, and students as well, to be, you know, if they have something that they need to do at home, but essentially still want to partake in whatever educational, you know, event is happening, that they can do that. I do think that, yeah, that hybrid is going to be something that is, yeah, going to gain popularity. And again, to return back to, I guess, data science, the more we can sort of upskill teachers and really promote the fact that data science has a place in education, the more viable these options are, because we have ways and expertise to be able to extract data and be able to see, well, yeah, sure, the student's at home, but we can still assess how the student's going, and we can still, I guess, you know, intervene when we feel like there's a problem, or, you know, oh, this student has actually been online a lot, and, you know, intervene and say, yeah, that's great that you're doing the work, but it's probably time to take a break, you know. And data scientists can be, yeah, very much a part of that conversation.
Yeah, it's great to hear your perspective, Mike, on that, because you've got your your teacher lens and your experience within the sector as a teacher. And then you've also got now a bit more of an objective external perspective with the research, with the data science. And yeah, I guess like any change, there's always benefits and challenges, and to be aware of those elements of like, whether it's in the workplace or not, hybrid versus fully virtual and a mix. So yeah, really interesting. I imagine many of us, including us at McCrindle, will be speaking into this space, watching it, like you said, learning from those that trial it and see the benefits and the challenges and the sacrifices and if they're worth it, so we can give these kids and these next generation, yeah, the best shot at an engaging education experience. So thank you so much for the chat today, Mike. It has been excellent to have you on the podcast. Look forward to our next episode together.
No, thanks very much for having me.
And if people would like to stay up to date with our latest McCrindle insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, follow us on social media, or head to McCrindle.com. And also we've got our education purpose-built sort of platform that we run called educationfuture.com.au, where we house our latest research and infographics about the education sector. So you can always head there as well. And if you're enjoying the podcast, we would love for you to leave a review. So once again, thanks for listening, and bye for now.